right. So next speaker, I'm going to call young, definitely very smart, renowned radiologist from Liaquat National Hospital. And the topic is clinical cases, acute and emergent condition of the bowel by Dr. Saleha Shehzad.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Dr. Saleha Shehzad. Thank you for having me over. And thank you, Dr. Anwar, for calling me a young radiologist. Although some people might have reservations, but still, I like to call myself that. Okay, so today I've been asked to talk about acute and emergent conditions of the bowel. Okay, so the objectives are that we would enumerate the causes of acute abdomen due to bowel related pathology, and we would be skimming through the salient radiological features of few of the diseases. As you all know that the list is very long, and we would try to accommodate most of them. So acute abdomen refers to acute severe abdominal pain. The causes can be malignant or surgical. The imaging modalities that are used in the ER are X-rays, ultrasounds, and CT abdomen. X-ray abdomen is usually the initial approach, and but it has its limitations. Two views are usually done, erect and supine, and decubitus if required. Usually if the ER physicians, they suspect abdominal, they see abdominal distension and they are suspecting obstruction, X-ray is the first imaging modality. But if there is severe abdominal pain and they're suspecting cholecystitis, appendicitis, then they go for ultrasound. But nowadays, as we all know, that CT has become the main modality of choice for the ER consultants. And for any suspected bowel obstruction on abdominal X-ray, for any suspected appendicitis, diverticulitis that has not been resolved on ultrasound, they go for CT abdomen. In patients in which there is high suspicion of ischemia or bowel perforation, CT is the modality of choice. We have had very good presentations by Dr. Saad and by Dr. Uwais about CT and MRI, but CT, due to its fast images, due to its availability, CT has become the modality of choice in the ER setting. So causes of acute abdomen can be classified in many ways. We would be going through this list. It could be infective inflammatory, which includes appendicitis, enteritis, diverticulitis, epiploic appendicitis, and IBD. Acute abdomen patients can present with bowel obstruction, which could be due to mass adhesions, strictures, intussusception, volvulus, or the reason could be vascular, including mesenteric ischemia, GI bleed, or vascular malformation. We would try to go through each one of them very quickly. Coming to appendicitis, we all know, we have as residents and even as consultants, we know that this is the most common pathology that we see when the patient presents in the ER. So what we see here, ultrasound is usually the first modality, and a linear non-compressible hypoechoic lesion with surrounding hyperemia with wall-to-wall thickness of more than 6 millimeters. The adjacent, you can see that the adjacent fat is inflamed and there is peri-appendiceal fat stranding. As we all know that ultrasound is operator dependent, and so it might happen that we fail to appreciate appendix on ultrasound, and it is then CT abdomen is requested. And on CT abdomen, you would be able to see this linear tubular structure, which is edematous with peri-appendiceal fat stranding and fluid in between. On axial images, it appears as a target appearance. You can well appreciate the fat, adjacent fat stranding, and the thickened cecum. Always keep in mind that whenever you are looking at a CT abdomen, please, please, please look for fat stranding, because at times this is the indirect sign which actually takes you to the diagnosis. Always keep in mind that history is very important. The location of pain there is very important. So if the ER slip is saying right iliac fossa pain, think of appendicitis. If it's saying left iliac fossa pain, do think of diverticulitis. It is the second most common cause of acute abdominal pain. So ultrasound was done and nothing could be found. So a CT was requested, and you can see there's thickened sigmoid colon without pouchings. These are diverticuli and with pericolonic fat stranding. Another such case, usually in cases of diverticulitis, CT scan is done to see the complications as well. So over here you can see that there was a macro perforation and an abscess cavity is formed with an air fluid level, thickened sigmoid colon with pericolonic fat stranding. It so happens that the patient has come with acute abdominal pain and lower acute abdominal pain, and we fail to see any appendicitis or diverticulitis. Kindly look for epiploic appendicitis, and again I'm going to stress that look for fat stranding, because that is the thing that is going to give you a clue. So in this case, there was a right iliac, left iliac fossa pain. Epiploic appendicitis presents as an ovoid fat density which is surrounding by this thin ring of enhancement, and most of the times you can see a central dot which is the thrombosed vessel. So please, I'm going to emphasize again, do look at the fat stranding. Colitis many times presents as acute abdomen. Colitis can be of any type: infectious, neutropenic, ischemic, pseudomembranous, and due to presentation of patient in the ER, CT is the first line of modality at that time. So over here you can see that the patient presented with acute abdominal pain and diarrhea, vomiting, and what you can see is thickened edematous colon, even the left sided, with ascites and pericolonic fat stranding. Another case of infectious colitis in which you can see the edema in the walls. This is the enhancing mucosa and the enhancing serosa with pericolonic fat stranding and ascites. One thing is that we have to differentiate it from carcinoma. In carcinoma, you see additional lymph nodes and the segment is not that long as compared to in colitis. Coming to inflammatory bowel disease, yes, I agree that for ulcerative and for Crohn's disease, MR is the modality of choice. But when the patient comes in ER with severe acute abdominal pain and there is acute Crohn's disease and the differentials are not narrowed down, CT is the modality of choice in Crohn's, acute Crohn's disease as well. So what you see is, as mentioned before, you see skip lesions, you see transmural inflammation. The strictures and fistulas are for the chronic cases. You see engorgement of vasa recta and terminal ileum involvement. So here is a case of Crohn's disease which the patient presented in the ER, and you can see that there is thickened terminal ileum with engorgement of the vessels and there is ascites. This is a case of chronic Crohn's disease which the patient presented with abdominal distension, and when the scan was done you can see actually stricture narrowing with the dilated proximal segment. In old age patients, when they come with acute abdominal pain, one of the top differentials is always ischemia. Ischemia can be classified as arterial or venous, and arterial accounts for approximately 2/3 of ischemia, while venous are around 5 to 10%. The radiological findings of arterial and venous ischemia are different, and one can differentiate it on CT scan. So as you can see over here, I'm sorry, the pointer has started, it's not working. You can see that the arrow is pointing towards the non-opacification of the SMA, and you can see that the bowel loops are, proximal jejunal loops are paper thin, and there is some fat stranding seen in the mesentery. Same patient, another view, you can appreciate that the dilated jejunal loops are paper thin. There is still enhancement of the mucosa, and the arrows are denoting a fluid level, which was actually due to hemorrhage within the bowel. So this was a case of mesenteric ischemia due to arterial thrombosis. Another case when the the diagnosis is delayed or the patient comes late to the ER, you can see this is the infarcted bowel and the arrow is pointing towards the air within the bowel, which is called nematosis intestinalis. What we need to see is also see the liver, because there is air in the portal vein as well. Same patient, we can appreciate that the air is also noted in the jejunal veins. This is a case of mesenteric ischemia, venous reason, and you can see the arrow is pointing towards SMV, which is not opacified. So kindly appreciate the difference between the walls that we saw in the arterial thrombosis. They were thinned out, while over here you can appreciate that the walls, the arrowheads are pointing, the walls are edematous and thickened with perientric fat stranding. So same case, another view, and thank you. We can see that there is engorgement of the vessels over here and the thickened bowel loop is seen over here. This is the non-opacified venous channel. So if the abdominal x-ray denotes that there is bowel obstruction, we need to get a CT, because the role of MDCT has evolved over the years. First of all, we need to know that whether there is an obstruction. Second, if the obstruction is there, what is the level of obstruction? What is the severity in the case and the cause of obstruction as well? So MDCT has a very has evolved, and it gives us a very global picture of what is going on. So after erect abdominal x-ray, in which you can see that there are dilated small bowel loops and air fluid level, CT scan was done. In CT scan, we can appreciate that the small bowel loops are dilated. The arrow is pointing towards the small bowel feces sign, which at times, if you are unable to see the point of transition and you're struggling, kindly start looking for the small bowel feces sign, and if you find it, it would be easy for you to see the point of transition. So as we discussed earlier, the small bowel obstruction could be due to adhesions, strictures, vases. This is a case of small bowel obstruction. The arrows are pointing towards the adhesion. Always look for point of transition. The change of caliber from a dilated segment to a normal caliber. Dr. Mukhtar, this is especially for you. So, this is a case of midgut volvulus and a typical corkscrew appearance. The corkscrew appearance is due to spiral twisting of these proximal duodenum and proximal jejunal loops. I'm sorry, the pointer is not working very properly. And over here, and this is an emergency situation and needs immediate surgery, otherwise the bowel would go gangrene. This is a pediatric case. The similar findings, if you see in an adult, you can see the whirlpool appearance of mesentery. This is a case of midgut volvulus in an adult patient. Coming to obstruction, large bowel obstruction, around 60% cases of large bowel obstruction are due to sigmoid volvulus, and this is a very characteristic picture of sigmoid volvulus, the coffee bean sign. And you see ahostral inverted U in the mid-abdomen, which is rising from pelvis, going towards the left side. You need to differentiate it from the cecal volvulus, which has, in which you can see that the hostras are present, a distended gastrous structure in the mid-abdomen, which is likely arising from the right side. If the diameter of cecum is more than 9 cm, that means impending perforation, and that needs to be told to the physicians. Sometimes the patient presents in ER and you have looked for appendicitis and diverticulitis and there is no obstruction. So start looking for free air in abdomen, and start looking for free air in retroperitoneum, because at most of the times we miss it and we need to be very careful. At times the history is not very specific and you actually have to look for it. So over here, as you can see, the patient came with severe epigastric pain and the pancreas was all normal, but when you see clearly, you can see that the duodenum is markedly thick-walled and there are free air adjacent to duodenum with fluid. This was a case of perforated duodenal ulcer. Another similar case in which you can see free air in the duodenum, same case of perforated duodenal ulcer. Another similar case in which you can see that the pylorus is markedly thickened and the small speck of free air is seen adjacent to it. So this was a case of perforated pectoral ulcer. The only key is have the findings in your mind and please keep looking for it. The last case that I'm going to show you is that of intussusception. And intussusception is also said as bowel within bowel. It gives a bowel within bowel appearance. You can see over here that this is ileocolic intussusception. The ileum is invaginating into the adjacent colon. And the bowel which is going inside is called intussusceptum. And the bowel which is receiving is called intussusception. So what you see over here is the edematous colon with the collapsed terminal ileum inside. The mesentery is also dragged with it, so you can see the fat within the lumen with the vessels as well. With this, I end my presentation. Thank you so much. There are many other causes that leads to acute abdomen which are related to bowel, but I think these are the most salient ones that we need to know. Thank you so much.